Okay, welcome back to the Content and Social Track sponsored by MAP. Thank them very much for sponsoring and making this possible. And welcome to the stage, Lindsay Lyons from Dell EMC.
Hello.
Thanks for joining us here today. So we're going to talk about, you are right at the hub of content strategy at Dell EMC. So you're global content strategy and a director there.
Yes, yes.
Awesome. So let's start first about sort of the recognition that you needed to do something new and what sort of launched this entire thing.
Yeah, it was about connecting with our customers on the way that they wanted to hear from us. We got an inkling that things were changing just by the way we consumed content ourselves, and knew that it was time to move.
Awesome. So you work at Dell EMC, which, similar to the SAP one we just saw, you know, you imagine, gosh, they must have just a force of marketers. But that was actually a challenge for you.
Yes. We had over 3,000 marketers at the time, and this is before we merged with EMC. And about 86% of those people were creating content or said they had something to do with content. So, you know, we couldn't exactly go out and offer a cease and desist to over 2,000 people.
And culturally, they were programmed to be pretty darn transactional.
Yeah, they were transactional machines. We measured, you know, speed to market, speed to buy, and we had a really well-oiled recipe that we wanted people to execute against quickly.
Great, and we just mentioned the sponsor, and I'm sure you guys have all talked to the vendors out on the floor. There are so many solutions and technologies and things that could enable. So you had an opportunity, you have a lot of data.
Yeah, we had, you know, Dell was founded on the idea of going direct to the customer. So we had an embarrassment of data and an embarrassment of riches with technology. And what we found was we'd fallen into a rut. We were looking at the same data, we were using the same technology in an old way. So we had to go back to the drawing board.
Right, and you mentioned those 3,000 marketers, which were all like, oh my gosh, I wish I had 3,000 colleagues to work on this. But that can be a challenge, and you were a little startup within that. So
we were.
Those three little people up there is you.
The three dots were me and my two colleagues, and the two colleagues there were really just from me going, hey, this is a big problem, and we need to focus on this. So we had to be the change engine inside the 3,000.
Awesome. Okay, so you did have content. You weren't starting from scratch.
No.
But tell us about what you were producing at that time.
Well, if you were a lifelong computer science engineer, I'm sure you very much enjoyed what we were putting out. But we were only connecting with the folks that we had been connecting with for the previous 30 years. It was highly technical and very in-depth, and what we realized was we were missing the big picture. People weren't coming to us with speeds and feeds in mind until very close to the end of a decision-making cycle.
Okay, let's talk about the decision-maker. So your customer is primarily, you're on the B2B side, so tell us about a typical Dell EMC customer.
You know, we service everybody from, you know, what we call G500, which is the top 500 companies in the world, all the way down to, we have an entire division that is focused on entrepreneurs, you know, one-man bands. So we have a absolute breadth of businesses that we support. And the overall goal is making them successful in their own rights.
Got it. Okay, and now that's the end customer, but your customer as the global content group,
yes,
is the marketer.
That's right. So while we were always focused on our external customer, we knew the only way that we could make a difference in the way that we speak to that customer is to talk to our internal customer. So those three people that you saw, we were selling ideas, we were selling concepts, and we were selling ways of working to our inside team of 3,000.
Great, and the way you were set up was, I know not, you're trying not to be a bolt-on, but a build-in, so tell us about that.
Right, so the analogy that we always used were, we were the mechanics fixing the plane while it was flying. We are still a highly transactional company, so you know, we got an executive sponsor who said, the minute I see something tick down, this is over. So we were very, very conscious about the fact that the only way this is going to work is if we work inside of the existing constructs and make it easy, as well as common sense And that's how we integrated with the teams.
As a center of excellence.
Yes.
Got it. Okay, so tell us about you. You've been at Dell for how long?
I've been at Dell for 15 years.
Wow.
I started in sales and moved into marketing through the sales enablement vein. And that brings a unique point of view of what customers actually need and want through my time. So also being in sales, you get a sense of the fact that people are only going to do what is inherently easy,
mm-hmm.
and
right.
using real language. So that was always that, you know, the spine of what we were doing.
Okay, so let's kind of dig in. So your content strategy, enabling that marketer to produce mm-hmm. good content that meets the buyers where they are and supports them through their journey.
Absolutely.
Okay, and your aha to help enable those 3,000 people through your three little people was?
We built a framework and a process that through serious amounts of research and, you know, just frankly going out and talking to the folks, it bolted into that existing construct. We knew that it had to flex with the global model where we are serving those 3,000 plus marketers,
mm-hmm.
but it also had to work for, you know, the one guy who was appointed, you know, managing entrepreneurship marketing in southern Italy, you know,
right.
So it's got to work in all scenarios.
Okay, let's walk through. We've got a couple steps. This is pretty, you'll find this pretty typical, the Marketing Sherpa approach, really trying to give you a blueprint to follow. So first, you took stock of what you had. So I know you did some pretty serious auditing and research before you started anything.
We did. You know, a lot of this came down to creating a case for change. And one of the main things we did is, like I said, we had an embarrassment of riches when it came to data. Also, our problem was never, we don't have enough content. So what we did was a content audit. And we looked at the type of content that we had. And what we found was the light gray boxes were gaps.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when it came down to the later stage, yeah, we had a ton of product content, but we only had one piece of content addressed to the global audience at the top of the funnel. And I was saying in one of the roundtable sessions earlier, we would say to our execs, boy, I hope our competitors are being nice to us because we're not saying anything in that space.
Right.
So that was about creating that urgency.
And then you filled it in, shared vision, gave hope, you had a plan.
We did. We said, what we can do is we can look at that content that we have piles and piles and piles of and find the stuff that is maybe underperforming and reallocate money and resource to fill in those blanks. So it was a net zero approach.
Great. And I know this is very typical in a lot of corporate marketers when they're planning and, you know, developing their execution plans, this is what you see. So tell us about what was happening here. Where was the customer?
The customer was not there. What we found was this was built off of website templates, email templates, CRM, you know, touch lists that they were like, we need to send out so many emails a week.
Mm-hmm.
What we did was we took a really close look at how the customer wanted to talk to us and then built our deliverables and plans around that.
I love it. You said one line when we spoke before, which was, I think the customer had become a line item in the execution plans.
Yes. So when we would ask people, who are you trying to speak to? They would say, oh, you know, IT people. And it's like, yeah, but what do they want? What do they need? How do they come to our content? And they're like, I don't know. I need three emails. So it's just about taking a pause and figuring out what people need and want from you.
Great. So let's kind of step through. First, you set up the team and the various groups you needed.
Yeah. So when we looked at what it would take to build a customer-first, data-driven strategy, we knew that there were key functionalities that had to be enabled. We also knew that we wanted people to have very deep knowledge and understanding to act as internal SMEs, so those army of three became an army of five,
mm-hmm.
and we acted as internal consultants. We divided the team out this way because we knew that in order to have the best of breed approach, these things are interdependent, but each role inside the company needed varying degrees of expertise in each of these things. So we could support the entire organization through having this collection of SMEs, but we could also then offer that deep knowledge where people needed it to drive their initiatives.
as host of this track, I think every single person that has a content strategy or a problem, even Sarah, you talked about lumens yesterday in our rapid fire, no one comes to you and says, here's budget to hire a content team. So it's figuring out how to do more with what you got.
Absolutely. The other thing we said is, if you try to go after technology or data on its own, if you don't have good content, you're just going to alienate people faster. Mm-hmm. You know, I was like, hey, we can target people one-to-one, but if you're going to hit them with a crappy headline, they're just going to unsubscribe faster. So well done. You know, so that was our main thing, was making sure that all of it improved at the same time.
Got it. So next you had to share vision and start managing change. You knew where you wanted to go, but this is, again, 3,000 people. You got to get the word out. So
yeah.
You started with a series of taking it on the road and doing some workshops.
We did. So those three people became lovingly called the road dogs. And we did a global tour and went out to all the regional teams. We started with the global teams, but that doesn't necessarily mean that we're all centered in headquarters. And we started talking to folks. Now, the cool thing about when we went out was we were able to get continual feedback, just like we tell our marketers to do with their content.
Awesome. So you started small, you got some early adopters, and you started to develop a bit of a framework.
We did. We went to them with a framework that we had kind of sketched out, and then when we started to see how they would adopt it, mm-hmm. We became more and more solid in the way that we were rolling it out as we went around.
I love this one, not dependent on tools or budgets to adopt, and adaptable to current processes. So you weren't making them do anything too crazy or have to make investments.
No. What we were asking them, we weren't asking them to change what they were doing every day. They were still going to be creating emails. They were still going to be designing banners at this point. We were asking them to change how they were doing it and how they were approaching it, putting the customer back into the center. And by just taking that pause and asking them to do that, it actually, they took the initiative to change what they were doing and what was produced at the end.
And you did it gradually.
We did. When you walk into somebody and you have a 24-month vision and you paint, you know, ideal state at the end, mm-hmm. everyone sits back and says, no. Sounds expensive, and it sounds like it's going to break things. No, thank you. So our immediate slide two was showing the phased approach. And the thing that I want to call out here is phase three, we did have an idea of what ideal state would look like, but we always said phase three, we're never going to quite get there because marketing technology is moving so fast. Every time we think we've reached nirvana, we're behind. So we've got to keep iterating. But let's build the foundation strong enough that we don't have to go through this painful process every time.
Got it. And you don't have to get all 3,000 at once. If you guys were in Brian's session yesterday with travel leaders, he talked about getting some early adopters, some early successes, and using them as your poster child for everyone else to get on board.
That's absolutely right. Yeah, we had to have internal case studies too.
Great. So let's talk about, you mentioned about the road dogs.
Yes.
What did you actually do? You went out and you did a ton of workshops.
We did a ton of workshops. The key things about these workshops were they always had to be in person, because when you talk to people about change, they're going to first freak out, then they're going to get angry, then they need time to process and really think through how this is going to affect them. So these sessions turned into psychology and coaching sessions.
Counseling.
It was sometimes it was therapy. We used to joke. We were like, hey, if we're pushing you hard enough, people are going to get upset. That means it's working.
Right.
So we went out and had really in-depth sessions with all the folks.
Great, and you just didn't go unarmed. Kind of walk us through. We're going to have a couple templates here that you guys can, when you download slides, you can actually get them.
So. Right. So we gave people a playbook, and that was essentially the content of the workshops in a printed playbook. I don't know about you guys, but I still write a lot of stuff down. I like to sketch things out. So we wanted to give people a place to do that. We also wanted to give them the copies of any slides that we were presenting so that they would pay attention mm-hmm. in the sessions. We gave them planning templates, again, not dependent on a tool. We were just saying this will frame how you think and how you work. We also recorded online sessions for people who couldn't make it in person. It's also become onboarding material for people who have come on board afterwards. And then we included case studies. So again, showing people there are people here you can call who've done this besides us. Mm-hmm. They're in the trenches. They'll show you how to get this done.
Awesome. And here's a little snapshot of that sort of system that you had there.
Yeah, these have become invaluable, and my best day was about a year ago. I walked through an area, and every single person in the department had the templates pinned up in their cubes. And I was like, yes.
It worked. Goodness. Awesome. So talk to us specifically about the workshop. So if someone here wanted to go and run a workshop, how did you do that?
So what we did was, the first thing we did was we made sure that the management and the exec were on board. It's very important for people to know that not only is this something they may want to do, it's something that they are expected to do. Mm-hmm. It also gives them permission to tune out to the rest of the noise and tune into what you're saying. We wanted them to come to us with a real life pilot or example of how they were going to put this in. And then the workshop was mimicking a planning session. So nothing was theoretical. Everything was real. We were dealing with real data, real things, real products. And then it makes it very much easier for people to translate this into how they're going to put this into action. Another thing we would say is, if people don't put this into action as soon as they leave this room, we've failed. Mm-hmm. So we wanted to make it so easy and so desirable that we never had that as an issue.
That's a note for everyone here, too. It's easy to go back to the office tomorrow and then put all your notes and everything aside and not quite get around to downloading these templates and stuff. So that's true, right? If you don't start on it right away.
That's right.
It doesn't happen. Okay, so now you're iterating. It's been in place for some time. Why don't you tell us about kind of the before after?
Sure. So before, again, our planning sessions, we actually didn't have planning sessions for a while because it was so automatic. Everyone just knew what was going to happen and it was going to go through. Customers were an item on the checklist, and folks just kind of said, it is what it is, and if I deliver my checklist, I'm doing my job. Mm-hmm. Now we are having really great discussions about what does the customer want to know. We've given our marketers permission to be creative and storytellers. So even the people who are managing SKUs are thinking about the customer experience and everything they do. And that's what this shift has really allowed them. And now it's an expectation.
So we've been talking about a lot of pretty abstract concepts and processes and structures. The output is actually hubs and content and pages and...
That's right. The output for us was a more user-friendly experience with simple things like, can you read this on your mobile phone? Mm-hmm. Can you download it in one tap? Is it a story that we know people are searching for without our product name in it? We used to laugh about how, you know, people would go out and they would say, well, I did a search and my content came on top. And we later find out, yeah, because you Googled yourself. No one else is talking about you. Way to go. So what this has turned into is a place where we are having conversations with customers, mm-hmm, on own sites and also on third parties.
Great. So what have you learned and where are you going now?
Well, we have learned a few things. So number one, I'm sure you all have heard this through various sessions, but if you are not putting your customer first in any content that you're creating, whether it is product information or a high-level storytelling paper, you're not doing it right. Mm-hmm. And in order for you to do that, you really have to put form factor and vehicle to the side. So we always say, you know, if your content strategy says something like, I'm going to influence change through two videos and an email. No. What are you going to say in those things? You know, that's the second part of the strategy, is coming together with how you're going to tell the story. The other thing is we have to continue to walk the walk. So we have got to continue to, you know, our story right now in the marketplace is innovation and transformation. We have got to be the proof behind what we're telling customers we can deliver, and teach them and walk them through that and put them at the center of the story and highlight their stories rather than our own. And then lastly, I'd say what this transformation has given us is the opportunity to tell our story in really new ways. So I was saying earlier, we're experimenting with virtual reality, and you know, it's freed up some of that tedium to go to customers the way that they want to and maybe haven't even thought about reaching out to their customers in the end.
Got it. And this is what it looks like today. So clearly the customer's right at the center of your content.
That's right. So again, you know, it isn't about what we do, it's about what they do and how we help them do it. Mm-hmm. I don't know if any of you've seen the ads, but you know, things like how does a cow tell the farmer it's sick? How does Top Golf turn a baseball stadium into an 18-hole course? The sexy thing in that story is not a server.
Exactly. Okay, let's talk results. So you had some pretty great initiatives you were able to launch with this.
Yeah, we've launched a few initiatives. As you know, we have the big brand campaign, but that's not all we do. We launched an initiative targeting the C-suite, and I think, you know, we've all probably thought we could get there. But what was interesting was this was launched with the C-suite coming to us and telling us what they wanted to accomplish, first of all. What are your outcomes? And then we, you know, kind of backed into like, okay, here's how we work together to get there, rather than saying, here's our suite of products that can make every dream come true. Mm-hmm. So that was a big shift. We have an editorial calendar that we sync from the marketing side with PR, comms, events, and our competitive insights team. So we look at the whole suite of content that's going out to our customer, and 9 times out of 10, we decide there's nothing to be said right now.
It's a lot about just being honest with yourselves about
cutting the
clutter.
Yep.
Let's talk about metrics. You've done well.
Yes, we have. I was saying in some of the roundtable sessions, something about content marketing and also knowing your business, our sales cycles are anywhere between 9 to 18 to 24 months. Mm-hmm. This is a fundamental shift, and just like any change, you have to stick with it. There was a good 3 to 6 months where I was like, I feel really nervous, and people are asking for results, and it hasn't proven yet.
Right.
So stick with it. Stick focused, and if you document what impact you want to make and what change you want to drive with the customer, it'll keep you focused. It'll also help you make decisions and prioritize.
Great. So if you guys want to ask any questions, we've got a mic runner, I think, here. You can just raise your hand. And I'm going to ask Lindsay to share her key learnings. So personally, what were your sort of top takeaways from this experience?
Yeah, so the first thing you need to know is who your customer really is. Through some of the data and through some of the insights with our customers, I realized a lot of my assumptions were false. I'll give you an example. When you think about talking to the IT audience, you think about very dry, very technical content. After we did our first round of research, what they really wanted was to be entertained, which, you know, again, it's like, oh, they're humans. Okay, yeah, we'll talk to you like you're human. But also know, it's not everyone, right? Be okay with not talking to everybody, because not everybody is in the market for what you're selling. I think the other thing you need to do is align on your framework and your vocabulary. We had so many different people creating content on the same topic, but saying it was doing different things, when actually they were both lead gen pieces. Mm-hmm. So, you know, customers could see them both, and they didn't know it came from two different departments. So just make sure that you're all speaking the same language so that you can share ideas and leverage each other's stuff. Mm-hmm. And lastly, write it down. It'll keep you focused, it will help you prioritize and make decisions about what's important. It'll also help you measure if you're making progress against where you originally wanted to go.
Yeah, something about putting a line in the sand, and part of that's not only saying about what you are going to do, but what you aren't going to do.
Yeah. And I think the aren't going to do is what was least comfortable for us, yeah, because it was always like, sure, pile more on, no problem. But stopping things and acknowledging that they're no longer what we want to do is, it's a tough one.
Awesome. Do you have any questions? Okay. I think we're all out of time, actually. So thank you so much, Lindsay.
Yeah. No problem.